And let's start with this report. Where are you seeing the biggest skill gaps, and what would it take to upskill the workforce?
So it's clear, Sherry, that, as you said in your opening comments, that we were dealing with this phenomenon well before COVID-19. Unfortunately, COVID-19 has made this far worse for two primary reasons. First, our education systems have been significantly damaged. We estimate that we have 1.6 individuals, mostly youth, that have been negatively impacted by COVID-19 in terms of getting access to education or quality education to get those skills for the future. Second, we've had a model from a business perspective that we haven't had a lot of investment in our people. We've been focused more so, and appropriately so, on mental health and physical health and all of the issues associated with COVID-19. So we've lost time in this issue. As a result, we see a big need and opportunity here. The need is to make sure people have the opportunity to be prosperous, as well as we see the opportunity of actually creating jobs. We've got to actually deal with the challenges that are out there. Specifically needed, how do I actually think about working in new ways with technology behind it? Second is, how do I adopt technology and scale? And third, how do I lead as a leadership team, entrepreneurs and the like, in this world that we're dealing with, which is creating so many new phenomenons? Markets that you all that were just talking about prior to this segment is clearly an example of that.
So who takes the lead in this charge? Is it the governments? Is it the private sector?
It can't be the government and it can't be the private sector. It's got to actually be a combination of the two. What we see here today is the amount of money, time, and collaboration that's needed has got to bring together public-private partnerships. What we see today is many businesses doing some things themselves. They're having impact, which is fantastic. And they're reporting on it to demonstrate their role as they think about the ESG as a SDG agenda. But the reality is they're doing it in small, fragmented ways. We've got to come together more so. So public-private partnerships, I'm, for example, part of an organization called GenU, which is an offshoot of UNICEF. It brings together governments and business to scale up. Our goal is to have impact on 500 million people over the next few years to try to give them the access, the quality insights and skills that are needed, and the opportunities for entrepreneurship, innovation, and long-term success.
As we head towards that post-pandemic world, what are business CEOs right now that talk to you every day most worried about?
Well, I think you see a couple of different things out there. You see the volatility in the marketplace still, even though we have generally a good positive trend with a lot of light coming at the end of the tunnel, assuming the vaccination actually comes in scale. Here we see a great disparity around the world. You see some countries pretty well prepared, and over the next 3, 4, or 5 months, they'll be in a well-positioned point of view. Other countries are still way behind in terms of securing vaccines and establishing quality vaccination processes. The second issue is, how do we make sure that the combination of the markets, some of the volatility that you just described, the uncertainty that you just described, is really being managed appropriately? And that's what CEOs want. They want that certainty. The third thing is, what's going to come out of the new administration in the US? And looking forward, what's going to come out of some of the new changes that will happen in Europe when you think about changes, for example, with Angela Merkel having her successor come in the fall? So these uncertainties are still top of mind for people. Last point I would make is, how do organizations manage this digital world that we're living in? We've gone through the biggest case study in the world in the fastest way possible. How many of the benefits will be sustained over time, and how many of the negatives will be figured out a way to mitigate those, so this way people can get back to more normalcy in terms of how they live, how they work, and how they consume?
And it's not just the digital business models that are changing, right? It's also, say, the tech decoupling and the fragmentation that we're seeing from these U.S.-China tensions that continue to rage. And even with the new Biden administration, we continue to see this tougher line. So how do businesses navigate this environment when we're still expecting more tensions down the line?
Look, the reality is every CEO is trying to manage through this complex world where you've got a number of different constituencies with various different points of view and different systems in place. Their opportunity is to focus on what they can control. Let's make sure that they execute well, bring the operational discipline to the points that they can execute on, influence when they can, maybe with others, have making sure they're bringing their points of view to the table in terms of what's important from a policy perspective, and let the others deal with it and scenario plan for all those uncertainties that may be coming your way. And that's the kind of conversations that are happening in the boardroom right now. It's a great deal of uncertainty and complexity, But the good organizations that are focused on sticking to their core principles, focusing on upskilling their people and redeploying ways of working and supply chains and consumer experiences, and being well positioned with their balance sheets to take some risk, those are the organizations that can move with speed. Those are the organizations that can take advantage of opportunities. And those are the examples of organizations that, if they do well for not only their investors, but also their broader group of stakeholders, great opportunity for long-term sustainability and value creation.
So are you seeing those changes already take place, especially when it comes to building redundancies in the supply chains, not to mention perhaps set some aside for compliance costs if you have different internets, different tech regulations and so forth?
You're seeing it in three different ways. You're definitely seeing an element of optionality being brought into both a supply chain analysis, but also customer experience. So in the last couple of months in particular, you've seen retail and consumer organizations do nothing but do internet sales, right, over the web or otherwise. When will they get back to retail? So they're looking at optionality on supply side. They're looking at optionality on consumer and consumption side as well. Second, they are building the right data and the right mechanisms to capture data and manage process most effectively and efficient in duplicative systems in terms of how do I comply with rules and regulations around the world. And we're going to see more of that come to life as you think about the fragmentation that was happening. And last but not least is how do you continue to invest in the broader stakeholder community? Each country now is looking at this. This is why it's important for business communities to focus on getting a singular group of expectations around how to report on climate, how to report on sustainability, how to report on what they're doing with their people and upskilling or equal pay, other things like that. And that's why we're looking for a global set of standards in terms of what to report to the stakeholders, get the information they need. The investors ultimately allow themselves to judge those that are doing and not doing in terms of the investments that they're making and the choices that they're making. And last but not least, society can judge their success with long-term sustainability in mind.
You have extensive experience in Japan, of course. What are you seeing in terms of those changes in Asian corporations?
Yeah, we see a couple of different things from an Asia-Pac perspective. One is there is a great opportunity to leverage the opportunities in digital and be a worldwide supplier in that regard. There's a lot of work that's been done in terms of bringing that educator workforce to life in terms of the business community. So that's an opportunity for them to explore it more so than perhaps other parts of the world. Second point is making sure they rethink their labor supply and look across the region. Third, make sure that you're actually thinking about the regional play. The underlying demographics in Asia are positive in terms of the rise of middle class, the increased amount of people that are coming through as you look at those moving from lower income to middle class. That'll require consumption, infrastructure, and the like. That's a big opportunity for the country in Asia to serve Asia well, in addition to being a supplier to the rest of the world. And that, I think, is a big opportunity for the Asia-Pac countries and gives them an opportunity for success. We see this in some of the growth expectations that the IMF has put out over the last couple of days. We see that as well also.
Bob, bringing it back here in the United States, of course, with the launch of the new Biden administration, we continue to hear talk about perhaps higher corporate tax rates, so 28%. Are you seeing some concerns among your clients, and how are you advising them to navigate this new environment?
So when we thought about this from a PwC perspective, the world order that we're living in right now requires us to look at five R's. Repair the damage that's been done, rethink what you're doing, reconfigure the assets, restart and report to gain trust in the system. Balance sheets around the world of our governments definitely are going to need repair. The only way to deal with that is either through a growth agenda, an inflation agenda, or some combination of the above coupled with taxes. Taxes on the individuals, particularly the higher incomes, and or at the corporate level. The U.S. is clearly going to be one of those examples as you change from the previous administration to this one. The question is going to be how much and how fast. Mm. And here again, there's going to be a really tough balance, making sure that we don't put too much uncertainty in the mix, too much pressure on taxation that will cause a negativity to the growth agenda that we expect to have coming out of the U.S. right now.
So the administration's
got to strike that right balance.
What do you expect in terms of that, especially with Congress playing a huge part in this, not to mention that we're seeing more moves towards regulation?
Well, the regulatory agenda is clearly another one to watch. Specifically, I think you're going to see more on the broader ESG and climate agenda. You see that with some of the announcements that would have been made over the next couple of days. That could be a good thing in terms of turning it into a positive, meaning the business community will have to deal with more compliance. That'll come from making sure that they do the right things, and the judgments will be done through enforcement. But if you go on the other side of the equation, some of the stuff that's being pushed for is trying to accelerate change. Change requires innovation. Innovation should create entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship mm-hmm. should create jobs. Right. So balancing this is really where the opportunity is for the administration coming into the role that they have, knowing they still got a big issue to deal with COVID.